Every year, at about this time, I typically preach about money to help people process their bonuses and what happens for the next year. I've entitled this message on money, Money is the Answer for Everything, taken out of the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 10, verse 19. Later on in the service, I will explain what this verse actually means. For now, I want to answer two basic questions. The first question is, does money actually make the world go round? The second question is, why is it so easy, or so hard rather, to earn money, but is so easy to lose it? The answer to this question is easier than the first one. The answer is simply this. We have a limited understanding of money, we have a poor understanding of money, or worse, we have a wrong understanding of money. Money, in its very essence, is simply a tool. It is a tool for measuring value. The same way that a measuring tape is a tool designed to measure length, width, and height using inches and centimeters, money is used to measure values. Now, in the ancient days, to measure value was to use weights. Weights were used to measure the value of a commodity. And that's why the Bible admonishes us, or the Jews were admonished by God himself, do not have differing weights in your bag, one heavy and one light. Don't do this idea of a set of values that's faulty. You've got to have one set of values if you're going to understand how to manage money properly. It says don't have different sets of values in your bag, which means when you go out into the marketplace. But it further says, not just that, do not have different measures of value in your house. And what that simply means is your values have to be constant regardless of where you are. Further, it says in verse 15, you must have accurate and honest weights and measures so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. Notice, you must have accurate and honest weights and measures. This is really the basis for understanding money, so that you may live long in the land that the Lord is giving you is the promise if we have the right, accurate, honest measures and weights. It's funny how people don't realize that money is just a tool. And if it is a tool, it is ludicrous to just be trying to produce more tools and overburdening ourselves with even more tools. The more we understand money, we understand it's not about the tool, but the skill in using the tool. It's a tool not just for measuring value, but it's a tool for exchanging value. In Genesis 47, verse 14, it talks about the time when Joseph became governor of the land. And Joseph gathered up all the money that was found in the land of Egypt, in the land of Canaan. And notice where it says he gathered all the money in exchange. Basically, money is nothing more than a tool that is used to measure value and to exchange value. These two coins, or the front and back of this coin, is known as the Lydian lion. Arguably, the first coin that was really used in the world. Now, some people say that longer than that, there were coins in China that predate the Lydian lion. But those were made of copper and bronze and brass. This was made of gold and silver mixed together. The reason why the Lydian lion is significant was when the Greeks conquered the world and took over Lydia, they discovered the idea of coinage. The Greeks utilized the revolutionary idea of coinage for building the agora, or the marketplace, thus formed the structure for the exchange of using money. Now, rather than a farmer trading his goods with another farmer, he can now trade his goods by selling them for money to a carpenter, a trader, a teacher, or even an artist can trade using money. It simply is a tool for measuring value and for exchanging value, and finally, for storing value. There's a very obscure story in the Bible found about Judah and Tamar. The entire story is recorded in Genesis chapter 38. I want to use this story because it explains the idea of measuring, exchanging values, but more importantly, the idea of storing values. Now, to give you a synopsis and a short version of the story, Judah was married to his wife. They had three sons. The first son married a woman named Tamar. Unfortunately, he died. Now, the next thing that happens is, in those days, is the second son is supposed to become the next husband so that the lineage of that family can continue. Unfortunately, that son also died. And so now the burden was left to a man named Shelah, who was the third son. Now Judah, worried that he might die again, decided to tell Tamar to just go home to his father and wait because Shelah was still too young. His daughter-in-law went home, and that's where we pick up the story. Now, before all that happened, Judah's wife actually dies. And then we find in Genesis chapter 38, verse 13, when Tamar was told your father-in-law is on his way to Timnah to shear sheep, she took off her widow's clothes, covered herself with a veil to disguise herself. Then she sat down at the entrance in Enamim. It says further, which is in the road to Timnah, for she saw that though Shelah had grown up, she had not been given him to be his wife. Now notice what happens. She was told that to wait. Now that she's waited and it didn't happen, she disguised herself. In verse 15 it says, when Judah saw her, he thought she was a prostitute, for she had covered her face. Apparently in those days, prostitutes in shame would cover their faces. She was not a prostitute. She was disguising because she wanted to confront him. In verse 16, it says, not realizing that she was his daughter-in-law, he went over to her by the roadside and said, come now, let me sleep with you. Now, this is the value proposition. I like this story because it kind of tells you that money is good for either good stuff like grain and food, and it's also for bad stuff like this. And what will you give me to sleep with you, she asked. Notice where the value proposition was met with, what is the measure or the exchange in this value? Now, notice what it says next in verse 17. I'll send you a young goat from my flock. And there you go, the exchange. The proposition, the measure, and the exchange. What's interesting about this story is it does not just capture this. In verse 17 and 18, it says, will you send me something as a pledge until you send it, she asked. He said, what pledge should I give you? The words, something as a pledge, or what pledge should I give you, is a conversation about the storing of the value. Your seal, she says, and it's scored in the staff in your hand, she answered. There you go. The measure, the exchange, and now the storage of the value. Let me explain. He said that she said that he would give her a goat. The goat is the measure of the exchange. The basis for that exchange was his seal and his staff. These things were actually storing the goat. Notice, if you don't walk around carrying goats all over the place, you need a place to store it so that it can be measured and exchanged. This is actually what money is all about. A measure, an exchange, and a place to store value. Now, a goat can be traded, not by trading goats and firewood, but with money. It could be traded for carrots and even for art. Money has taken different shapes over the centuries. Regardless of whether they become paper, checks, bonds and certificates, credit cards, or even digital money, it doesn't matter what the shape or form is. It is basically a tool to measure, to exchange, and to store value. The question, therefore, does money make the world go round? The simple answer is, yes, in a way, but the correct answer is it's simply a tool that makes the world go round. Now, notice where it says it's a tool for measuring value, for exchanging value, and finally for storing value. If it's a tool, then we know it has a purpose. A hammer has a purpose, a measuring tape has a purpose, and so does money. And what is the purpose of this tool? Simply this, to measure values. Now, arguably, we could say that a shoe is a tool. Some will say it's fashion, but for the most part, a shoe is a tool for walking. People who are smart can measure the value of the things that they buy. Trying to get more measuring tools is not the idea for money. Rather, the skill at being able to measure the right values is really what you want to do. More importantly, to be skillful in measuring the value that it creates. Let me explain. A builder does not go around trying to count how many hammers he has, but understands how skillfully he can use that hammer to build more houses. A teacher does not go around trying to figure out how many blackboards and erasers and chalks she has, but how to understand how to teach better students. A doctor does not go around counting how many stethoscopes or how many thermometers he has, but how many patients he actually serves. In other words, the key to this tool is to be skillful at the use of it. You can't measure something you don't really know. In June of this year, I taught two messages, Ordering Our Disordered World and Who Stole 2020. The goal of these two messages was to help you learn about values, and I would highly encourage you to go back and listen to these two messages if you really want to get good at this thing called money. It is nothing more than a tool. It has a purpose, and it's to measure values. In the same way that it's a tool for exchanging value, it has a purpose, and that purpose, as you have guessed, is to exchange values. Now, imagine the house and the hammer. The skill and being a skillful person in building differs from person to person. We're not all the same. Our tools may all be the same. Our money may all be the same. But the skill level of a teacher, a shoemaker, a doctor, or an artist varies from person to person. Thus, the goal is to be skillful at measuring and exchanging value. But some of you are probably thinking, yeah, right. We need one hammer, but we need a lot of money. And rightfully so, because a hammer is less valuable than money. Why is that, you might ask? Because money represents our time. It represents our energies. And more importantly, it represents all our stored values. The idea, therefore, is exchange. When we become skillful at exchanging things for higher values that take time rather than consuming our values, we grow. And that's the game. Are you growing or are you consuming? Ask yourself this question. How do you use your time, which is one of your greatest values? How do you use your energies? And what do you do with your stored values? Are you simply consuming it or are you growing it? In other words, it is just a tool, but it has a purpose. The more skillful we are at measuring values, at exchanging values, and finally, at storing values, the greater levels of growth we're going to see in our money. Money is really about storing and spending. When you look at money, the two parameters are what you store and what you spend. What you store is effectively what you save, and that's how you become wealthy. With spending, the better way to use a word spending is the word give. I'd rather use the word give. I give my money to someone in exchange for a value they give me. The more I think of it that way, rather than just spending my money loosely, I actually create greater value. In the ways of spending, the more you spend, you eventually end up in poverty when you spend more than you actually store. When you're storing, what you're storing can also become something that is bad for you when all you do is store and store and store and get past the levels that are righteous and end up in greed. People who are greedy never stop wanting more money. They actually declare, "I want more." It's funny that the people who are poor or in poverty say, "I don't have enough." What's interesting about these two phrases is they're interchangeable. People who are greedy can actually say, "I don't have enough, that's why I want more." And people in poverty say, "I want more because I don't have enough." The reason is because, in the spiritual sense, poverty and greed are twin brothers. People who are greedy actually have a poverty spirit that want more, and people who are greedy actually create people who end up in poverty because they don't have enough. They actually work against each other. The advice of Scripture in terms of storing is simply this. Jesus said, "Do not store for yourselves treasures on earth. Wisely figure out the highest values in your life that will last forever, but store for yourselves what ends up in heaven." That's the key to storing. As for spending, the advice Scripture gives us is, "But godliness with contentment is great gain." When you're godly, coupled with contentment, you will notice that you will end up with great gain. If you've been tracking with us through this whole year, you may have noticed that every week I practically wear the same shirt. This day, however, I have a new shirt, and over the last few weeks, I have different shirts because this is sales season for shirts. People who are wise about their storing and spending have more things to gain with money. When was the last time you took stock of your storing practices? And what was the last time you took stock of your spending practices? I don't want to tell you exactly how to spend your money. I simply want to explain to you that money is nothing more than a tool. It's nothing more than a tool that has a purpose: to measure values, to exchange values, and to store values. Now, because of this reality of this tool, it is actually no ordinary tool, because this tool is actually very powerful. Now, notice where it says in Matthew 6, verse 24, no one can serve two masters. Either you will hate one and love the other, or you will be devoted to one and despise the other. The words "can't serve two masters" tell us what money can look like. When you have a master, that simply means that thing or that person has power over you. Then it goes on to say in the second half of the verse, you cannot serve both God and money. The reason why Jesus said that was because he was trying to express a very simple truth about money. While it's a tool and while it has a purpose, it is very powerful. It can actually cause you to put your trust in money, which is faulty. In Mark chapter 4, verse 19, it says, the worries of life and the deceitfulness of wealth. Now, this is important to understand. As great and powerful and valuable money is, it is deceitful. These days, we don't worship a bronze or golden calf. We actually worship a calf of money. And there's a lot of deception that goes with this idea when we end up worshiping the wrong things. One deception that even the people of faith have is people who have a lot of money are bad. That's not really true. I've actually met a lot of people with a lot of money who are very good people. One other thing, deception, or thing that we think is true is people who are rich are greedy. That's not true either. I've found a lot of very generous rich people. The other thing that people believe that's not true is people who are poor are godly. That's not true either. I've seen a lot of poor people who are very ungodly. And the idea that people who are poor are not greedy, it just watch the people who are gambling and lining up in lotto shops. And you understand that greed is something that paralyzes not just the rich or the poor, but everybody. Probably the final two lies, particularly for those of us who believe in God, is people who are rich are blessed. That's not true either. And people who are poor are cursed. The simple reality is when people are rich, it's probably not just because they're greedy, but because they're skillful at the using the tool and knowing the purpose for it. People who are cursed probably are not, people who are poor rather, are not really cursed, but just lack the skill in understanding the reality that money's a tool. It has a purpose to measure, to exchange, and to store value. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 4 says, don't get deceived. Don't wear yourself out to get rich. Don't try to get as much of this tool. Use it properly. Don't trust on your cleverness. Rather, don't put your trust in riches. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, and in all your ways, make him the master of your life, and he will make your path straight, particularly in this area and the thing that we call money. Money is a tool. It has a purpose, but it's also very powerful. We can end up putting our hope in it. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 5 says, cast but a glance at riches, and they are gone, for they will surely sprout wings and fly off to the sky like an eagle. It says, cast but a glance. Think about a glance, a quick look, and they're gone. That's what riches is. Now, earlier, I mentioned to you the verse in Ecclesiastes 10:19. It says, a feast is made for laughter, wine makes like merry, and money is the answer for everything. Now, before you get the conclusion that money solves everything, what this verse is actually saying is, money is like a feast that is made for laughter, which lasts only for a moment. Wine makes like merry, which is a merriment that it eventually wears off. It says money is kind of like that. Don't be deceived. Don't be thinking and putting your trust in money, because it doesn't work that way. And finally, money is so powerful that people can fall in love with it. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 9 says, those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap, and many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. It didn't say those who are rich, but those who want to get rich. It is those who fall in love with money, that get into these foolish and harmful desires that end up plunging them into ruin and destruction. And that applies to both rich and poor people. Finally, in verse 10, it says, "For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people who are eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs." I remember the day I read this verse. It scared me, and it made me think about being plunged into ruin and destruction and being pierced with many griefs. Then I learned another verse in Hebrews 13, verse 5. "Keep your lives free from the love of money," not from money. People who say that, "I don't need money, I hate money, money's from the devil," don't understand what they're talking about. Money is a tool, it has a purpose. Your goal is not to trust it, not to put your hope in it, most of all, not to love it. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." If you've ever wondered this promise that God gives us, that He will never leave us nor forsake us, it was actually given to the people who know how to keep their lives free from the love of money and have learned to be content with a beautiful shirt that I'm wearing right now. Let me summarize. It's a tool. Money is great. It's a great tool for measuring value. It's a great tool for exchanging value. It's a great tool for storing value. It has a purpose, and that is to measure values, and to be skillful at measuring it is really the secret. Secondly, it is a way to exchange values. That's the purpose. And finally, a way to store values. But be warned, don't put your trust in it. Don't put your hope in it. Don't put your love in it. The answer to our question is really simple. Remember the Lord your God, for it is He who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms His covenant, which He swore to your ancestors as it is today. This promise that has reigned for over thousands of years is as effective and as it's true today. But if we will remember the Lord our God, put our trust and hope in Him, and love Him with all our hearts, it is He who will give us the ability to produce wealth. Lord Jesus, we proclaim your love and promise over us. You said, "We are not to love money because you promised that you will never leave us or forsake us." And while we know that we will need money as a tool for living on this earth, we choose to put our trust and hope and love on you and in nothing and no one else. Be glorified in our lives this day, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, Amen.